neighbors and representatives. So thank you for this and thank you for your understanding that we're unable to turn off the lights, but I think at least it worked pretty well that we could see it. I was worried that if we turned them off completely, we wouldn't be able to turn them back on. So here we are. So I am sure that people have a few questions regarding the movie. Please, you're welcome to come, raise your hands, and or come here and ask us. Maybe you would like to do that. I would like to know, if I may, something about the production of the film, the directors, and about the script writing that you produced.
Well, thank you all. To answer Patricia Nance's question, the production started in 2016 while there was the conference on the 400th anniversary of the death of Inca Garcilaso in Cordoba, Spain, the city where he lived his last 25 years. The university has an internal institution called the Cátedra Intercultural, and they were interested in celebrating or commemorating the 400th anniversary with a production of a long feature film, fictional film. So I've been doing research on Inca Garcilaso for several years. My doctoral thesis was on Inca Garcilaso. And they knew that that was the reason why I was at that conference, but they didn't know that I was also a scriptwriter, because I've written film scripts since my early 20s. So they asked me for a script. And I was able to provide a general plot, but another scholar, Carlos Clemenson from the University of Cordoba, who is also a poet, filled the parts related to Andalusia, because I wasn't bad at working many of the sites. So we started filming in late 2016, the Cusco scenes, where Garcilaso lived his first 20 years. And then when he moved to southern Spain in 1516, he actually passed through those places that you've seen, in Madrid. He lived almost 30 years in Montilla, which is a town an hour away from Cordoba. And then he finally moved to Cordoba, where he wrote the Royal Commentaries. This was a production basically financed by the University of Cordoba with the participation of my own university staff and a professional team of filmmakers belong to an independent production company called MAE Producciones, based in Cordoba, Spain. And you can find them on Google because they have several films related to cultural personalities of Cordoba. The role is my money, the bond, and so these are educational films that the purpose is to engage students and teachers in these figures and to encourage them to read these wonderful writers. So I would ask you to come here because I'm sure people
are. Bueno, en primer lugar, enhorabuena, la entrevista me parece muy interesante. Y cuando usted se presentó, dijo que había una intención didáctica. Vale, entonces, tomando en cuenta sus palabras de una intención didáctica, hay algunos puntos de vista que me parecieron interesantes. Iniciando desde el título, Inca Garcilaso, ¿vale? Como él se denomina, después el subtítulo, que es el mestizo, como a lo largo de la película todo lo vemos. Pero también la parte visual, cuando uno ve al actor, el actor es un español más, ¿vale? Entonces no se puede decir que es un mestizo. Entonces me gustaría preguntarle si eso fue intencional o era el Inca, como se definió, el mestizo como la sociedad lo definía y lo que uno ve, la persona contemporánea que en realidad uno no ve mestizo, un ve un español, uno ve un español más. Y hay algunos motivos que son muy interesantes y algunas partes del contenido que son interesantes. Por ejemplo, solamente se alude una vez explícitamente al y usted va a pedir igual que yo casi cuando se hace la tiranía de Atahualpa, ¿vale? Que es una tiranía española. Bueno, pues yo que los españoles llegaron a la tiranía de Atahualpa, la que es una tiranía de Atahualpa Huáscar, pero explícitamente se habla de tiranía de Atahualpa, aunque se sugiere, bueno, la desaprobación de las personas como España, varias naciones más allá, etcétera, etcétera. Entonces, primero, la cuestión de la etnia, de lo que es, de lo que es distinto, segundo, lo que es tiranía. Y me parece muy interesante el juego que hace en determinados momentos con las cuestiones del imperio, por ejemplo, la presencia romana en España, cuando él habla de que los indios desnudos fueron aquellos que no fueron civilizados por los incas, entonces, los diferentes conceptos del imperio y cómo se aparece en ese imperio, y finalmente lo que es el concepto de sangre. El interesante paralelismo que en la película se establece entre Abel Maya y el Inca, porque bueno, algunas de las series son obvios, pero son diversos por los parámetros propios del imperio, la religión de los niños. Entonces son esos tres paralelismos. La cuestión de lo que uno ve.
Yeah, well, it's actually four questions. The first concept of Mestizo and why the actor was more second hand, typical Mestizo, which I think, so the tyranny of Atahualpa, that happened right before the Spanish and these groups. And I guess the key question there is why he doesn't refer to Spanish in the name of tyranny, as a translation for that. But the first question was of the concept of empire. Is parallelism or analogy between the Roman Empire and the Spanish Empire? And the last one was the concept of block and how we can trace a parallel between Inca Garcilaso de la Vega and Abel Maya, the leader of the Morisco rebels, the Apocado, which is a highlands near Granada. I think that summarizes your wonderful question. Yeah, very well. Do you want me to answer in Spanish or in English? Any preference? Okay. Okay, let's do it in English then. Of course. Yeah. The concept of mestizaje is very broad in many terms. It's true that the word itself started to be used when applied to human beings with the clash of Europeans and indigenous peoples, you know, after 1492. However, it was preceded by a scornful use. Mestizo was called a hybrid animal in general. A hybrid horse, a hybrid dog was called a perro mestizo, a caballo mestizo. So it was an insult to put it anyway. Racial mixture had also occurred in Spain. Although they didn't call themselves people, I would say a lot of mixed blood, for example, Muslims and Christians, they didn't call themselves mestizos. They were considered in many ways because of the obsession, the Spanish obsession with blood purity, mixed blood. So, yeah, that goes to the last of the questions, but I'll go back to that too. Regarding the actor, I don't know, it's a little bit subjective. He's an Andalusian. I have seen Spaniards that are very blonde with blue eyes too, so we didn't have a typical mestizo, and that's very hard to define because there are many degrees of mestizaje. I'm a mestizo to a certain degree, you are, we all are. No? He doesn't look Indian, that's true, that's what you mean. But he doesn't look Nordic either. He looks more Andalusian. There is another issue here. We really don't know how Inca Garcilaso looked like. All the portraits that we have seen are from the 20th century. Now, the famous portrait is holding his quill was painted in the early 20th century by a Peruvian artist called González Amaro. That's the one that is kind of the official portrait, following Velázquez's very famous portrait of Longwell, which is found in the Museum of Fine Arts of Boston. So we have no idea how he looked. The verbal descriptions of Inca Garcilaso said that he had kind of a destrieña, like a light dark skin, nariz aguileña, like a falcon nose, y frente ancho, a broad forehead. That's all we know about his appearance. We don't know much more. Indeed, in Spain, when he moved in 1560, there is no single testimony that he was discriminated because of his appearance. So he might have well looked similar to the actor. We don't know. The second question about the tyranny of Atahualpa, the definition of tyranny in the 16th century is whoever that acts according to his or her own desire and interest. It's not only a political term. It is, but it's much broader. That's why even today we can talk about tyranny in love, for example. When someone is a tyrant, and that person does whatever he or she wants with us. In political terms, it's any kind of illegitimate power that acts according to the self-interest, and not according to the interest of all the population. And it's also common in the political theories of the 16th century, particularly the neo-scholastics on the Jesuit order, as it was inspired by Mariana, those political theories that were also Jesuits that Garcilaso read. The legitimacy of any political power is given only when the king is at the service of the common good. Anyone who privileges or prioritizes his own interests is a tyrant. So Garcilaso doesn't call the Spanish king a tyrant for that reason, because he truly believes that the Christian faith is superior to the idolatry of the demons. Although he's very ironic regarding the application of the Christian faith, because one thing is what the priest said, and the other thing is what the converts did. So he's always claiming for justice, but he doesn't dare to declare the Spanish domination is illegitimate because of the religious aspect of that domination. The empire, there is a parallel definitely. It wasn't like a commonplace in the 16th century. Many authors compared Spain to Rome. Garcilaso was a step forward and he compares the Incas to Rome, because he's very explicit about that. He said Cusco was another Rome in its empire, because he found that there was a very advanced civilization, even when the Incas didn't have the Christian faith before the arrival of the Spaniards. They were able, with what Garcilaso calls the natural life, they were able to build and organize a highly efficient society in which there were no poor, no beggars, so everybody was well taken care of by the Inca. And that's something that he thinks that the Christian governors should follow. Also, he's basically retrieving and vindicating the dignity and the political powers of his maternal relatives. And the concept of blood, I'm happy that you asked that, because today when we talk about racism and the origin of racism in the 16th century, we are applying an anachronism. The word race existed, but it wasn't applied specifically to a spiritual effect in Muslims and Jews. The Indians were not classified as a race, at least not at that moment. That changed in the 18th century, but at that moment they were classified as a blood, and that's why most mestizos were in trouble before the Spanish legislation, because having an Indian mother, they were considered to be suspects of idolatry. And they were investigated, and there was a point in the 1580s in which the church prohibited mestizos to become priests because of the inherent idolatry law from the mother's side. So Garcilaso had to overcome these obstacles. He wasn't only a mestizo, meaning he had idolatry blood. He was also what is called an hijo natural, he was born out of marriage, and that put him in a social position that was very risky, because he wouldn't be able to access several of the positions that he applied to, particularly in the church in the 1590s in Cornwall. He wanted to be a sacristan. And he was named one, but he wasn't allowed to exercise as such, because he couldn't demonstrate that three generations before him, they were all Christians, obviously because of his father, who was not a Christian at the beginning. So, yeah, the concept of standard of law is essential, it is central to the social categorization of individuals at that time. And that's also to belong to that cultural framework. He probably wasn't discriminated, at least in Spain, but he wasn't able to access several of the privileges that all Christians were able to access. I don't know if that answers the question. I don't understand myself too much, but if I have a question related to these issues or other issues, I think we still have a little time, Patricia, right?
Can I ask in Spanish?
Sí.
Okay. ¿Y qué pasó con su hijo?
Oh. ¿Qué pasó con su hijo? What happened to Inga Garcilaso's son? Yeah, that's a very interesting question because we know very little about him. But what we know is very interesting. He was probably born in the early 1580s from a slave that Garcilaso had at his service. And she was a Morisca, that is a Moorish converted into Christianity. So she was also a suspect for the law to paganism. He was a son conceived and delivered out of marriage. From what we know, the documentation, Garcilaso names him in his testament in 1616 and leaves him an important sum of money and some of the properties, but he doesn't say that Diego de Vargas, that was his name, was his own son. In the 1650s, one of the greatest scholars of Garcilaso, José de Lana, identifies a document in which Diego de Vargas refers to a song that he wrote by his own hand, the Royal Commentaries, meaning that he copied it. So there's this hypothesis that Garcilaso dictated his work, because from the documents in the 17th century, you know that his hand trembled a lot. He probably had Parkinson, so he had to dictate. And that's something interesting because when we read the first edition of the Royal Commentaries, the punctuation is for different. Modern editions are not reliable, but the punctuation of the first edition of 1609, the first part, 1617, the second part, reveals that Garcilaso was thinking orally and that the text was probably conceived to be disseminated in a loud reading, not with the eyes but with the ears. So that's one aspect that still remains to be developed. I'm working on a critical edition, but I'm still halfway, so I don't want to be too much away. And Diego de Vargas, without him, Garcilaso probably wouldn't have finished his work. He became a priest and eventually died in Cornwall at the 1650s. That's all we know for the moment about his son.
Quick question, it might be slightly off topic. There's a lot of controversy in Christopher Columbus Day. Do you think it should be changed to something like National Native Heritage Day to celebrate Native American heritage?
Well, as you said, this has limited to them, but yeah. I'll try to answer. Yeah, there are arguments on both sides. I tend to agree with the indigenous people today because despite all the contributions of the Spanish culture, and for example, many of us in Peru are from Spanish, and they're our mother tongue, and we have been raised within the general references of Western and Christian culture, we still have to recognize that great injustice was perpetrated in the long period. Despite the good intentions of the Spanish legislation, we also have to say, contradictory to what many think, the legislation de Indias was very protective, as opposed to the 19th century and the 20th century Creole national states. Just look at what's going on in Ecuador, for example, or in other parts of Latin America. So it's a political issue. I tend to lean towards the defeated side, and but I recognize, have to recognize the value of the Spanish contributions as well.
Anybody else?
Jim first.
What role did you play?
What role did you play? There's a couple of cameos where I appeared. My role was Monsanto. And you probably have guessed that. I'm of course, I don't appear there as Monsanto Pizarro, just one of the extras, because that's what I was technically known. Monsanto Pizarro is great rebel. Is the younger brother of Francisco Pizarro. Francisco Pizarro was killed by his opponents in 1541. And in 1542, Charles V, the King of Spain, decreed that so-called new laws that dispossessed the conquerors of their lands. So there was a great rebellion of the conquerors, and the leader of that rebellion was Gonzalo Pizarro, who was a very close friend of Captain Garcilaso de la Vega. There's another friend there, the Pablo de Lima, who plays Francisco de Carvajal, who was the lieutenant of Gonzalo Pizarro. But we didn't want to develop those characters because Inca Garcilaso talks about Gonzalo Pizarro with great admiration in the second part of the royal commentaries. We wanted to restrict the plot to the life of Inca Garcilaso and his position and vis-a-vis the crown, vis-a-vis the Spanish culture, and obviously vis-a-vis the indigenous relative that he left behind. So Gonzalo Pizarro became a less and less important figure in the film, although it is very important in the royal commentaries and in Peruvian history in general. He intended to betray the independence of Peru in the 1540s.
We're coming to an end, and I can't resist to ask the final question, if I may. Thank you all over to the HR snacks. For me, this is I'm teaching an anthropology class of peoples and cultures of Latin America and Caribbean, and we have just finished the period of the encounter. And I think that to talk and to look back at concepts of mestizaje and all these other frictions that separate people and put them together, it's really an opportunity to see, to think back at how, and think of how concepts change, and at the same time there is the persistence of this strange way of, the human way of creating categories that separate us and that emphasize difference and also that bind people together. So here we see not just race, but the beginning of these notions of race that we haven't seen before, or they're right before the encounter. And at the same time, this other alliance is that if he was a friend of Gonzalo Pizarro, he was a betrayer of others, and there's all kinds of different things. And I actually wanted to ask you one specific thing about the choice of language, because the speech that is used by the different characters, I don't know if necessarily illustrates some of the changes or of speech of that time, But maybe, but at the same time, it was very effective for us to follow the other messages. So I don't know if you could put those things together in terms of how language and political and personal alliances, and you mentioned Mestizac at that time, because at the end, Garcilaso appears as a very lonely character in that sense. But just anything to wrap up, because I know we're about to finish.
Something that should be mentioned and underlined is that the word mestizo that started as an insult became something very different thanks to Garcilaso, great deal. In the Royal Commentary, in one of the last chapters of the first part, he says, "Es nombre que nuestros padres nos impusieron, y por eso, como yo, y me llamo. I am very proud of being called a mestizo, not because of him. To be a mestizo was to be even better than just a Spaniard or just an Indian, because he could handle both worlds. He was very modern in that respect. He's one of the few people at that time that fought in two different codes, obviously in two different languages too. So the concept of mestizaje at that time, thanks to us, has become positive. However, in the rhetoric of nationalism in many countries of Latin America, mestizaje has become kind of a brand name to basically white indigenous cultures. Being a mestizo like Garcilaso is bigger than being a mestizo like, for example, Aurelio de Quesada, who was one of the very scholars from Garcilaso in the 20th century. And so the word has a big range of names. And regarding language, we chose Quechua for that passage in which Garcilaso's uncle in Cusco, who was an Incan prince, is telling him the origins of the Incan Empire, which is a passage from the Royal Commentaries in Spanish, but Garcilaso says that he heard it originally in Quechua. He doesn't write in Quechua, but he says he's translating that passage. So we try to go back to the supposed original, because obviously that not believes in Spanish. And according to people in Cusco, the translation is pretty faithful. We were tempted to include Arabic in the speech by Aben May, another Morisco reverend. But we thought that it would have been probably too much. It's not a historical term. It would have sounded probably nice, without this Arabic, it's a very beautiful language, but it would have implied looking for translators, the actor being speak Arabic, so it was a little bit inconvenient, I would have to say, that the budget was limited, as you can see, we did what we could with the limitations of the university budget. I mean, we had sold the idea to Netflix or Marvel Pictures, which would probably be, we have that passage spoken in Arabic. But thank you for the question.
Que además es presidente de la Federación de Peruanistas, la Asociación Internacional de Peruanistas, o sea que nos representa a los peruanos en muchas oportunidades y estudia muchos temas de interés para todos, como este caso de Inca Garcilaso de la Vega. Thank you very much to all of you that have come and accompanied us, Professor Mazzotti, and for our host, BNCC, and the Director of Ethnic Studies, Patricia Matthews. Thank you so much. And all of you here, please enjoy. We still have some food, some fruit and vegetable food back there. If you want to taste some of it, we could not bring pisco sour for you because this is a university and there are students here. Había estudiantes, no les pudimos traer pisco sour, será para otra oportunidad. Gracias.
Muy explicado en inglés. Ahora para el público en español, ¿qué pasó con su hijo?
Sí, la pregunta es muy pertinente porque el hijo, aunque no sabemos mucho de él, cumplió un papel fundamental en la escritura de los comentarios reales. ¿No? Hay un documento de 1652, es decir, bastante después de que el Inca muriera, que murió en 1616, en que Diego de Vargas, el hijo del Inca, el hijo natural, declara que él escribió de su mano los comentarios reales, lo cual en esa época se entiende como que copió los comentarios reales. Y es posible que haya copiado de un dictado. Es una hipótesis que se está manejando. Hay documentos del Inca en esos años, en la década de 1600, 1610, en que ya se le ve una mano temblorosa. Entonces es posible que le costara trabajo escribir de su puño y letra y dictara el contenido. Por lo tanto, el hijo fue como una especie de amanuense, de copista. Que definitivamente fue una parte fundamental para que este manuscrito llegara a la imprenta.
¿Y qué pasó con su esposa?
Bueno, no se casó. La madre.
La esposa de Garcilaso la Vega.
Es que no se casó. La madre del hijo era una esclava morisca que se ha identificado como Beatriz de la Vega. Sobrevivió al Inca porque es nombrada en el testamento. Le deja algunos bienes, lo mismo que a Diego de Vargas, su hijo. Pero no sabemos cuándo murió. Se calcula que en 1620, unos pocos años después. Pero esa historia queda un poquito difusa.
Dígame, ¿y cuándo empezó el periplo en Estados Unidos de la proyección del Inca Garcilaso de la Vega?
¿De la conmemoración, dices?
No, ¿desde cuándo empezaron a proyectar la película del Inca aquí en Estados Unidos?
¿La película?
Sí.
El estreno absoluto fue en noviembre de 2017.
¿En Lima
o aquí? Perdón, 2018, no. En Estados Unidos.
Sí.
Fue en mi universidad, bueno, en Boston, el 2018, pero en Lima se había estrenado en septiembre del año pasado y el primer estreno mundial fue en la ciudad de Córdoba, en noviembre del 2017.
Okay.
Desde el año pasado, el 2018, hemos estado llevando la película, que es de carácter educativo, no se vende, pero cualquier maestro que quiera acceder a ella para sus clases puede ubicarme y yo le envío un enlace privado. Voy a descargarla. Mi dirección es muy sencilla: jose.mazotti con doble z doble t arroba tafs, que es el nombre de mi universidad, o sea, tufts punto edu.
Bien, perfecto. Y de aquí, ¿cuál es el siguiente paso? ¿A dónde van?
Bueno, tenemos pensado llevarla próximamente a Cuba, a fines de noviembre. Y hay otras invitaciones en el camino, pero hasta que no se concreten, quizá mejor no revelarlas.
Bien, muchas gracias. Felicitaciones.
Muchísimas gracias.
Gracias.
Estoy trabajando ya, pero estoy entrando a hacer el MFA. Muchas gracias. Voy a hacer el MFA. Ajá.
Bueno, nosotros.
Víctor Lagos.
Lagos.
¿Se lo puede pagar? Adelante. Sí, ya terminé.